Okay, hi. Hi. So, just plan to do some MCQs on probability. Let's see how many. Not sure. Right? Okay, yep. I'm audible, yeah. So, P is the number of cars per minute passing through a certain road junction between 5 pm and 6 pm. Okay. And P has a Poisson distribution with mean 3. What is the probability of observing fewer than 3 cars at any given minute in this interval? So, fewer than 3 cars, Poisson, mean 3. Probability of observing fewer than 3 cars at any given minute, and per minute, P cars are passing. So, first of all, I don't remember all my formulas. So, let's just see Poisson. I thought they would be the basic questions first, but anyway. Okay, I'm not sure this is the right thing. Yeah, next one. I don't know anything about Poisson and all, and so out of the two-digit integers, let me guess. So probability is x less than 3 is 0 plus 1 plus 2, yeah. Okay, just put the values in the formula given at Poisson distribution. So Poisson is fixed for something, right? Right. Out of all the two-digit integers between 1 and 100, a two-digit number has to be selected at random. Working right, two digit number has to be selected at random. What is the probability that the selected number is not divisible by 7? Okay, this one's easy. All the two digit numbers from 1 to 100, I have to select one of the for all the two digit numbers from 10 to 100, right? So 10 to 99, select at random, and what's the probability that's not divisible by 7? So, how many multiples of 7 between 10 and 99? So first of all, how many total cases are there? 10 and 99, between 10 and 99. I have my 11, I have my all these cases. So in these cases, I just need to find out how many multiples of 7 are there and minus those. 7 ones are 7, and for 100, I don't know what comes here. So let's see. Seven ones are 7, 7 twos are 29, 7 fours are 14. So 7 fourteens are 70 plus 7 fours are 28. That gives me 98, right? So 98 is the last multiple. First one is 14. So 7 ones are you remove. 13 multiples are there. So 77 should be the right answer. What do you think? Yeah, 77. There are total 90 two-digit numbers. Out of them, 13 are divisible, right? We found out 13 are divisible. So that's fine. Next, suppose a fair six-sided die is rolled once. Probability on the dice is 1, 2, or 3. Okay. If the value is 1, 2, or 3, the dice is rolled a second time. So if it's not 1, 2, or 3, it's not rolled a second time. And what is the probability that the sum... Okay, first of all, if it is 4, 5, or 6, it's not rolled a second time. But 1, 2, and 3 are rolled a second time. So this is one case. at least 6, 6 is at least 6. After the first one, you might get a 1, you might get a 2, you might get a 3, you might get a 4, you might get a 5, this is at least 6. You might get a 6, this is at least 6. Similarly for 2, 4, 5, 6. And for 3, I have 3, 4, 5, 6. How many tick marks are here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Out of how many cases? 6 threes are 18, 18 plus 3, 21. So 10 out of 21 will be the right answer. Oops, 5 out of 12. 1, 5, 1, 6, 2, 4, yeah. I got, okay, wait, 18 plus, so all these cases were there, 18 cases were there, and out of them, here I had 3 cases, 3 plus 2 plus 1, which was 5, yeah, which was 5, 4 plus 3 plus 2 plus 1, which became, total probability is, okay, 15 by 36, 5 out of 12. So there were 9 cases out of these 36 cases, right? And in the starting, if you get 1, so you have to add 1/6. My method was wrong. Okay. It's rolled once. Value is 1, 2, or 3. It's rolled a second time. So if the value is 1, 2, or 3, it's rolled a second time. I'm not sure I understand this problem. So let me read it once more. If it's rolled twice, what is the probability that the sum total values of that turn is at least 6? Okay. How to reduce bicep size? Okay, so any idea about this? If it's 1, 2, or 3, it's rolled a second time. So how did he get these different possibilities? Okay, there are 9 of them, yeah. But he took them out of 36, not out of out of 18. I took it out of 18. First time 6, total probability 15 by 36. 1, 5, 1, 6. So 2 cases, right? Thanks, Palash. 2, 4, 2, 5, 2, 6, so 3. That's the same thing that we got, yeah. We got 2, 3, 4, 2, 3, 4, yeah. 2 plus 3 plus 4, which became 9. And then I counted that 1. I counted that 1 as one of the cases, right? But I had to just add that since that was of a single roll. So that's fine. Random variable x takes the values plus 1 and minus 1 with probability half. Values of the cumulative function f of x at x equal to minus 1 and x equal to plus 1 is. So, random variable x takes the values plus 1 and minus 1. Both have the probability of half. Cumulative function at f of x equal. So, the cumulative at minus 1 is going to be half. And at 1, it's going to be 1. So, I think the answer is half and 1. Let's check if I'm wrong. Half and 1, correct. Cumulative means just add up the frequency up to there. Question 5. If two fair coins are flipped and at least one of the outcomes is known to be a head, what is the probability that both the outcomes are heads? Okay, so one of them is known to be a head. That means, so I have two coins, one of them is a head. What is the probability that both are heads? The other one is either a head or a tail. So is it half? Wait, two coins are tossed, that then it's not going to be half. Look, tail, tail, head, 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 tail. What did I miss? Nothing. So how many of these? 3 out of 4, right? 3 out of 4. What is the probability? Okay, it's half. No, it's 1/3. How? since we know one is head, there are only three possibilities: head, tail, head, head, and tail, head. Probability of both heads, oh, sorry, probability of both heads is of course 1/3. That was our sample set, right? Difference between the expectation of the square of a random variable and the square of the expectation is denoted by R, then. So I have my random variable and expectation of the square, and the square of the expectation is denoted by R. Is R equal to 0? No. No, R is not going to be 0 because when you square something, you're multiplying it by itself, right? The values will change relative to each other. So less than 0, no. Greater than equal to 0. Variance. Non-zero variance is always positive. That's fine. Finite sequence of random variables, let mu x be the mean and this be the standard deviation. Another finite sequence y of equal length, we derive from this as let mu y be the mean, and which of the following is incorrect? Okay, so we are getting this new sequence by multiplying it by some value a and adding some value b. Adding any value b would not change the standard deviation. And multiplying this value by x will multiply the standard deviation by this value a. So what's the new mean and what's the new standard deviation? Index position of mode is the same as index position of mode of y, right? Which is incorrect. Oh, sorry. So index of median is same as index position of median of y. Yeah. Yeah. Even if this is negative, yes. Mu y is equal to a into mu u. This is incorrect, right? Standard deviation doesn't change by multiplication. Yeah. It only changes by addition. Is that so? No, it doesn't change by addition. It only changes by multiplication. The difference between consecutive values will not change. Correct. Mode is the most frequent value. Position of median will also not change. So for the mean, they have opened out like the sum of all y values. And on both sides, when they take this sum, it remains the same. So mean is affected by multiplication and by addition. But standard deviation is the square root of the variance. And so it's not affected by any addition. Here you have plus b. Here you have minus. Yeah, it's not affected by addition. Deck of 5 cards, each carrying a distinct number from 1 to 5. Let me remove this nav bar. Much better. Deck of 5 cards, each carrying a distinct number from 1 to 5 is shuffled thoroughly. 2 cards are removed one at a time from the deck. What is the probability that the 2 cards are selected with the number on the first card being 1 higher than the number on the second card? Okay. So we are removing 2 cards and we want to know what is the probability that the 2 cards are selected with one card, with the first card being 1 higher than the second card. So for each value, 5, I have 4, for 3, I have 2, for 4, I have 3, for 2, I have 1, but for 1, I don't have any 1. So I have these 4 cases in which it's successful, right? Yeah. And in total, how many cases do I have? 5 values for this position, 5 out for this. So I'm going to go with 4 out of 25. 1 out of 5. Number on the first card being higher than the number. Oh, being higher. Not being one value higher. I thought it's consecutive, so bad mistake. Two cards from 5. So, how many in total? Since the order matters, there are 20 events, four favorable cases, 5-4, 4-3, 3-2, and 2-1. Oh, I was correct, but my total events was wrong. Why is it not 25? Each total is 20, not 25. Five options here. Correct. Okay. Assembles computers. Probability of a faulty assembly of a computer is P. Okay. The company therefore subjects each computer to a testing process gives the correct result for any computer with a probability of Q. What is the probability of a computer being declared faulty? Okay. First of all, the probability of a faulty computer is P. Okay. Now, the company has a test which it does, and in this test, the probability of giving a correct result is Q. What is the probability of a computer being declared faulty? Okay. First of all, that will be the probability of it being faulty along with a successful result. So, PQ. And it will also be the probability of the computer being not being faulty along with a wrong result. Right. This is AND, not multiply. Okay. What's the formula for having probability A depends on B? Like here, this one, A depends on B. Bayes rule, probability A depends on B is probability B A into probability A divided by probability B. That's great. Two cases, right? The multiplication was correct. It's a faulty computer and it's declared correctly. It's not a faulty computer and it's declared wrongly. Those are the two cases. What else? What is the probability that a divisor, okay, is a multiple of 10 raised to 96? Okay. How many different multiples are there? Is a multiple of 10 raised to 96. How many multiples of 10 raised to 96 are divisors of 10 raised to 99? I have 10 raised to 96 itself, 10 raised to 97, 10 raised to 98. And 10 raised to 99. What happened? Yeah. I clicked on that white button. So in total, how many are there? 1, 2, 3, 4. And total number of cases was following multiples which are also divisor. 99, 98. Oh, yeah. 2 into 96. Correct. Four into 96, five into 96, eight into 96, ten into 96, twenty into 96, twenty-five into 96. I don't know how I'll calculate this. Right, in a square grid, hundred by hundred grid. How did he write this part? Divisors form a 100 into 100 grid. In the grid, the multiples of 10 raised to 88 are the numbers below and to the right of 10 raised to 88, which form a 12 cross 12 grid. Nice. So for the divisors of 10 raised to 99, you have a 100 into 100 grid. Why? Because if you see the grid for 10 raised to 5, this is 4, 10 raised to 4. So it gets arranged in this grid which is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that means the formula that they've given, two numbers, nope. Arrange the divisors in a square grid. How many divisors are divisors of 200? So you pick this position of 200. Okay, and all these divisors are common, right? So you have these in common. That's it. Similarly, for our problem was 10 raised to 99 and 10 raised to 96. So 10 raised to 99 had a huge grid that was of size 100 into 100. And in that we picked the 96th position, so that was of size. So when we picked the 96th position, we picked it and then we got the grid of size 100 minus 3 and 100 minus 3. Total number of divisors, 100 into 100. And all of these numbers, they came over here. So we had 16 out of 16 rows, 16 rows and 16 columns. That were the answer. Terrible accuracy, but that's why I'm doing this, to improve. Unbalanced dice, 6 faces, 1 to 6. Thrown, probability, face value, odd, 90%. Probability, even. Okay, so that's given. Probability of getting any even numbered face is the same. If the probability that the face is even, given that it is greater than 3, is 0.75, okay. Which of the following operations is closest to the probability that the face value exceeds 3? Okay, I'm lost. Unbalanced dice, 6 faces, 1 to 6. Face value is odd, 90%. So, odd has a probability of 90%. 90% the probability of even. Odd is equal to 90% the probability of even. So 0.9e plus 1 equals to 1. So that means probability of even is 1 by 1.9. I don't think that's significant here. Probability of getting any even numbered face is the same. So probability of each face would be into 3. Probability that the face is even, given that it is greater than 3, is 0.75. Probability that the face value... Okay, so what is the probability of the face value exceeding 3? For 4 and 6, I know it. I have to find out what's the probability for 5. For 4 and 6, this is the probability. So just into 2. And for 5, what's the probability? It is given that is even and greater is 0.75, okay. Which one is the closest? So I'm going to guess this one. I don't know the method what to do, right? Let us explain. All the probabilities add up to 1, obviously. It is given that odd is this. It's also given that x2 equals to x4 equals to x6, all even are equal. It's also given that x4 plus x6 divided by probability of getting greater than 3 even number. So 4 and 6 out of 4, 5, 6 is 0.75. Solving all the equations, you just get that. Nice. You just take those equations and solve them. Either CS or maths every day. If she studies CS on a day, then the probability that she studies maths on the next day is 0.6, okay? So, okay. If you studied CS today, then your probability of studying maths tomorrow is 0.6. If you studied maths on a given day, then your probability of studying CS the next day is 0.4. If she studies mathematics on a day, then the probability that she studies CS on the next is 0.4, given that Aishwarya studies CS on Monday. So on Monday she has studied CS. So on the next day she has studied maths with a probability of 0.6 and she studied CS with a probability of 0.4. then what is the probability that she studies CS on Wednesday? So this is Tuesday, and Wednesday she can study CS from her maths, which would give me 0.4 of 0.6. So that would give me 0.4 into 0.6. Or from her CS she went to maths, so again 0.4 into 0.6, which gives me 2 into 0.4 into 0.6. So 0.8 into 0.6, and 8 sixes are 8 twos are 16, 8 threes are 24, 48. No, that's wrong. Point 0.6, okay, from maths, and then the next day, 0.6, 0.4, 0.4 into 0.6 into 2, 0.24, 0.4. Okay, so maths on Tuesday is 0.6, CS on Tuesday is 0.4. Maths on Tuesday and CS on Wednesday, 0.6 into 0.4, 0.24. Oh, it's 0.4. I thought it's 0.6 over here because I did the minus. Maths to computer science is not going to be 1 minus 0.4. It's going to be 0.4. Stupid. Let x be the random variable following normal distribution with a mean plus 1 and a variance 4. Okay. Let y be another normal variable with mean minus 1 and variance unknown if CDF at minus 1 is equal to, if probability x less than or equal to minus 1 is same as the probability y is greater than 2. Standard deviation of y is, no idea. What are they doing here? Normal distribution formula they are going to use. I think so. Z equals to minus 1 minus 1 divided by 2, which is minus 1. Probability of Z less than minus 1 is equal to probability of Z greater than 1, 0.5 minus probability of Z being between 0 and 1. So this is from the table of normal distribution. These values are fixed. If he's 3, then okay. No idea. Uniformly and randomly select a permutation from 20 permutations of 1, 2, 3, 12, 20, 20 factorial. Probability that 2 appears in an earlier position than any other even number in the selected permutation. So 2 has to appear before any even number. So either all the odd numbers appear and then 2 appears, and then all these numbers appear. All these odd numbers, how many odd numbers are there? 10 odd numbers. 10 factorial ways of them being here. How many even numbers are there? 9 remaining even numbers, 9 factorial ways. So it could be this, or the 2 could be over here, right? 2 appears earlier than all other events, and this guy goes over there. So 10 factorial into 9 factorial. No, sorry. 10 factorial, 9 factorial, and this 2 has 10 positions. 10 factorial into 9 factorial into 10 divided by 20 factorial. Is that it? So 10 into 9 factorial is same as saying 2 into 10 factorial. Okay, this is really nice. I think it would be 920 because this has 9 different positions. No, it doesn't have. Let's see what logic they've used. All even numbers, same probability of being first. Oh, ignore odd numbers, okay. And there are 10 of them. So you ignore the odd numbers because they can come anywhere. So on top, in the numerator, they'll be the same, denominator, they'll be the same. You have to just consider the even numbers. Wow, what is the probability that a given list of even numbers will start with 2, 1 out of 10? 10 even numbers start with 2. Given a set x where xi equals to 2 raised to I, sample s belongs to x is drawn by selecting each xi independently with a probability pi, expected value of smallest number in the sample. Xi is equal to, so basically a set of powers of 2. This is a set of all the powers of 2. And we are picking a sample from this set by selecting each xi independently. So the previous choice does not make any difference to the current choice. Probability of half. Smallest number in the sample S is expected value of this one independent. Two is the smallest number in this sample. Is it? How n? 1 upon 2 raised to 1. What formula is this? 1 upon 2 raised to 1 into 2 raised to 1 plus 1 upon 2 raised to 2 into 2 raised to 2, 1 upon 2 raised to n into 2 raised to n. Probability half for the first. Okay, for the first pick you have a probability of half. Second pick, again you have a probability of half multiplied by the probability of half of your first pick. Okay. Smallest number in the sample is n, because this expansion goes to n. 1 plus 1 plus 1, n times. Suppose you break a stick of unit length at a position chosen uniformly at random. Expected length of the shorter stick is. So you have a stick. Randomly you are going to break it. So let's see, the stick has 100 centimeters. All the values up to 99 have equal probability. Expected length of the shorter stick is. So over here you can pick any of these 50 points, right? The shorter stick will have a length from 1 to 50. Again, over here, when you pick the same 50 points, the shorter stick will be on the right side. It will have a length of 1 to 50. Wait, if you cut here, 25, if you cut here, 25. If you cut here, 40. If you cut here, 40. If you cut here, 50. If you cut here, almost 50. So the probability is more likely, there are more chances that the shorter stick, okay, from here, the shorter stick will be a part of this. So I'll choose half of 50. Nope. This is, there's got to be some formula of this. Chosen uniformly at random, expected length of the shorter stick is. Let's see what is the formula. The smaller sticks will range from 0 up to 0.5. Each equally probable. Average will be 0.25. That's it. 0.25, which is the answer. Another approach, some Stack Overflow link. Uniform, so integrated it from 0 to 0.5 plus 0.5 to 1, and you did 1 minus x since the shorter stick would be the other side. 1 by 4. Okay, that's complicated. I like this explanation. 0 to 50. Average is 25. 4 fair 6-sided dices are rolled. Probability that the sum being 22 is x divided by 1296. Value of x is 4 dice. 22 is x by 1926. So in 4 dice, what's the probability of 22? 22, for 22 I need, let's say, 22 divided by 4 first of all is 5.5. So I need at least 1 6 1 5 1 6 1 5. That gives me 22. Or I could have 3 sixes and 1 4. That gives me 22. I think that's it. Yeah, that's it. So now how many ways to make length 4? So how many ways to permute this? And this one again 4. So there are, so basically what I'm saying is this 6565, I can rearrange it as 6655 or 5566 or 5665 or again. So basically from 4 positions I have to choose 2 for 5 and the others will be 6. So 4 choose 2, 4 factorial, and the other one I have to choose 1 position. So 4 choose 1, 4 choose 1 will be 4 factorial divided by 4 minus 1, 3 factorial into 1 factorial, so 4. And 4 choose 2 will be 4 factorial, 2 factorial, 2 factorial, 2 factorial, 2 factorial, 4 into 3, 2, 4, 2, 2 3s are 6, 6 plus 4, 10. Answer will be 10. I really like this software, OpenBoard. What is it? OpenBoard, open source whiteboard. You can draw on top of this. Okay, how did they do it? 666, yeah. 3 6s 1 4. So yeah, number of ways to obtain this. 2 6s 2 5s. Number of ways to obtain this. Exact same thing that we did. Security system at an IT office composed of 10 computers, out of which 4 are working. To check whether it is functional, they pick 4 at random. System is deemed functional if at least 3 of the 4 inspected. Okay, so how will we do it? Total ways to pick 4 computers out of 10. So 10 factorial divided by 10 minus 4 factorial, yeah. At least 3 are fine. All 4 are fine plus 3 are fine. Okay. All 4 are fine. 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. 4 factorial. How come? 4 are exactly working out of 10. Total ways 3 are fine. Okay. First not working, other 3. Second not working, other 3. Should be a better way to do this, right? All the cases he has just taken and then divided that by total number of cases. Each of the 9 words is written on a separate piece of paper. 9 pieces of paper are kept in a box. One of the pieces is drawn at random. Expected length of the word drawn is? So that's an easy question. Why is it 3.8 to 3.9? 3, 5, 5, 3, 6, 4, 3, 4, and dog is 3. So add up all these and then divide by 9, you will get this value. Great. Given positive integer lying between 1 and 100 is not divisible by 2, 3 or 5. Okay, nice. So how many divisible by 2, 3 or 5 is what I'll find out. How many divisible by 2, 1 to 100, 50. 3, 1 to 100, 33. 5, 1 to 100, 20. How many among these are common? How many times have I counted the same number? So this was all add. A union B union C is what I'm finding. So now I need to minus A intersection B. 2 and 3 is same as saying divide by 6. When you divide by 6, you get 17 or 16. you get 16.5. So 16 minus 2 and 5 divided by 10 minus 3 and 5 divided by 15, 100 upon 15. These are 5, 20, 6. So then finally you minus multiplication of all, which would be 30. 100 by 30 is simply 3. So 16 minus 6 minus 3, 20, 25, sorry, 16 plus 6, 22, 22, 25, 35, 50 plus 20, 70, 70 minus 35, 35, 35 plus 33, so 100 minus 35 minus 33, 67 minus 35, that's our answer, which would be 32. So let's select 32, wrong, 259. Total 100 numbers, maybe the maths was wrong, out of which 50 divisible by 2, 33 divisible by 3, 20, that part was correct, counted twice, correct, counted, oh, I have to add this 3, not minus it. At the end, I have to do plus 3, not minus 3. Good question. 20 out of 82, accuracy is still 40%. Let S be the sample space and two mutually exclusive events, A and B, such that A union B is equal to S. So the entire sample space has the both events cover the entire sample space. P dot, probability of the event. Max value of PA into PB is, what's the max value of PA into PB? What do they mean? Mutually exclusive events. So A plus B I know will add up to 1. They're mutually exclusive, so they have no intersection. They have no intersection. And A equals to 1 minus B. So probability of A, let's call it X. Probability of B is 1 minus X. Probability of A into probability of B would become X multiplied by, I'm not making sense, something I'm missing out. Max value of P into PB. Oh yeah, yeah, wait. Multiplication of these two will be simple multiplication. I am lost. But set of all outcomes, mutually exclusive, cannot occur simultaneously, right? Mutually exclusive, intersection is 0, that's what I thought. PA plus PB is 1. We know that AM greater than equal to GM, what's that? Plus PB, the whole thing divided by 2 is greater than equal to, arithmetic progression is greater than geometric progression. Whole thing is greater than equal to square root of PA PB into PA PB. Okay, I have no idea what happened here. Oh. Half into half. Look at this logic, is so nice over here. Heads and tails, probability of, okay, A and B are getting a head and a tail, so half into half. Damn nice. For each element in the set of size 2n, an unbiased coin is tossed, okay. The 2n coin tosses are independent, they don't depend on each other, okay. Element is chosen if the corresponding coin toss was a head, okay. Probability that n elements are chosen is, brilliant question. So I have 2n positions, let's assume n is 2. What is the number of combinations I can make with either true or false? 1 or 0 in each position. So of course 2 raised to n options are there. Now in these options, element is chosen, probability that exactly n elements are chosen. So what is the probability of having n ones? that would have to be 2n is given to me. From where can I learn probability? So even I'm not sure, that's why I'm trying to do these questions and learn. Some nice websites that I found were this one. Probability. Then another nice website that I found was this one, IndiaBigs Probability. And I'm trying GFG now. Khan Academy, if you want to learn all the concepts. If you don't know the concept, then Khan Academy, of course. So Khan Academy, you can just watch the videos and you will understand all the concepts. That's it. Practice on these three sites then. Fine. 2n coin tosses are independent. Element is chosen if corresponding toss was held. Probability that exactly n elements are chosen. So out of 2n positions, wow, from 2n you are choosing n, and total number of probabilities 4 raised to n, because it is mainly about heads and tails. N heads out of 2n tosses, 2 probability. Oh, this is the binomial theorem. Binomial theorem. Probability of 2n from 2n, so 2n choose n positions, and each probability of a success is half. Each probability of not a success, this is 2n minus n. This is binomial theorem, okay? You can just see that. Let f of x be the CDF of x. Probability that a less than x less than b. Welcome. Binomial. Yep. So, you know, when you flip a coin, there are two outcomes, heads and tails possible. Now, look at this. If you are flipping two coins, okay? So in the first flip, heads or tails. In the second flip, again, heads or tails. So total four outcomes get possible. 2 raised to 2. So now you notice over here, probability of number of heads. Zero heads, probability of zero heads is 1 out of 4. Probability of one head is, these two cases, 2 out of 4. And probability of two heads is 1 out of 4. So it does not become a standard. The distribution is like this. Towards the center, it will be more. You might think that 0, 1, and 2 will all have equal, but they're not equal. So how do you calculate this? There's a formula which helps us calculate this. Where is it? Here. So probability of having x. So in a coin toss, suppose two coin tosses and probability of heads is 0.5. Right. So how many successes do I want? X successes. So for X successes, my probability will be, first of all, from N, I have to choose X. So you know combinations permutations, then this is NCR formula. Right. From N values, I want to choose two values. So from four values, I want to choose. So from four values, I want to choose two positions for two heads, right? For two heads. And then I just do half raised to x, two heads are needed. And if two heads have come, how many will be non-heads? All the remaining elements. So n minus x. So we put that formula over here. And we got half raised to n and half raised to 2n minus n, which is n again. And here, from 2n, you're choosing n. It's just that formula that we've plugged in. I'm also not quite sure if there's some explanation that can be done. Otherwise, it's just this formula. Probability of x success out of n trials. Yeah, n trials, each one has a probability of half. CDF is something I don't know, so I'll guess the answer and go ahead. Let x be the PDF. PDF is this. Probability is area under graph. So just integration was supposed to be done. integration from a to b, since it's from a to b, integration of f of x from a to b. No, thank you. But do watch a Khan Academy video or something for binomial theorem and all. That playlist is the main one. I saw it a long time back. I'll be seeing it again tomorrow. I just wanted to see how much I remember. That's why I'm doing this video. Just watch this. You'll understand everything. All this, why this formula is made and how they made this formula and all. This playlist you'll find on YouTube also. I'll also watch this soon because I don't remember most of the stuff. Not able to solve these things. Box P, 2 red balls and 3 blue balls. Box Q, 3 red balls, 1 blue ball. Select a box. Choose a box. Choose a ball from the box such that each ball in the box is equally likely for that. Okay. Given that a ball is a red ball, probability that it came from box P is, first of all, how many ways are there to get a red ball? Thank you. How many ways to get a red ball from P? Okay, I have 2 out of 5, right? 2 plus 3 is 5 and 2 are red. So from P, I have 2 out of 5. From Q, I have a chance of a red ball 3 out of 4. Now, chances that I'll select box P is 1 upon 3. Chances that I'll select box 4 is 2 upon 3. So what's my total probability? If you notice over here, my total probability will just be this probability of getting a red ball from here, from box P, and probability of getting a red ball from box Q. So I just have to add up these two probabilities. How do I do that? 1 upon 3, so 2 upon 5 into 3, plus 3 into 2 upon 3 into 4. Plus half, and 5 into 3, 15, 2 upon 15 plus half, which is same as 4 plus 15 upon 30, 4 plus 15 upon 30, which is 19 upon 30. Get it? So basically it's a tree. First of all, how many ways of getting red from P? How many ways of getting red from Q? How many ways of getting P? So you have to multiply these two. You go to P and then you pick red, or you go to Q and then I just added them. Let's see if my logic is correct or wrong. 19 out of 30. Wrong. Answer is 4. Let's figure out why. Half into 2 by 5. Okay, same thing. Oh! I found out probability of red ball. Probability of red ball I didn't have to find. I had to find probability of red ball from P. This is probability of red ball. Probability of red ball from P is this, 2 upon 15, right? So you just have to do, both of these have to come true. Both of these have to come true. P1 and P2. So given that it's a red ball, find that it came from box P. P1 divided by P2. So how many probabilities of a red ball? All those cases, you just have to divide by the probability that it came from the box P. Okay, this was a great one. From box P. The formula is just divide it. Random bit of length n, constructed by tossing a fair coin n times and setting a bit 0 or 1 depending on the outcome. Probability that two such randomly generated string is not identical is, first of all, let me assume that n is equal to 3. Okay, so let's make it easier. N is equal to 2. So I can have 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0 or 1, 1. Now, what is the probability that they are not same? So let's say I got 0, 0. Now for the next string, right, I need to get 0, 0 again. So 1 by 4 into 1 by 4. Now notice this. What is this 4 actually? It is just 2 raised to n. isn't it? It's just 2 raised to n. So 2 raised to n into 2, which is same as 2 raised to n plus 1. Okay, wait, something's wrong. Okay. This is the probability of selecting 0, 0. Then what's the probability of selecting, of not selecting 0, 0? 1 minus probability of selecting 0, 0. So probability of 0, 0 is 1 upon 2 raised to n. What's the probability of not 0, 0? 1 minus 2 raised to n. Not means 1 minus, right? If there's a 90% chance of winning, there is a 100 minus 90, 10% chance of losing. Head greater than 0, tail greater than 1. Coin is fair. So, px not identical will be 1 minus px. Half into half into half, n times. Great. Fair coin 4 times. What is the probability that 2 heads and 2 tails will result? Okay, 2 heads and 2 tails. So this is binomial problem again. I have probability of 2 heads that I want to find. First of all, from 4, choose 2. Then what is the probability of 1 occurrence? Half. I want 2 occurrences. What is the probability of 1 tail? Half. I want 2 tails. So when I substitute everything, I get 4 factorial divided by 2 factorial, 2 factorial, 4 into 3, 2. So 4, 3 divided by 2 becomes 6. So this 4c2 is 6. Half raised to 2 is 1 by 4. 1 by 4 into 1 by 4 becomes 1 by 16. 6 by 16 becomes 3 by 8. I'm going to pick answer A. Yeah, great. 150 MCQ questions of 1 mark each, with each question having 4 choices. Each incorrect answer fetches minus quarter mark. Suppose 1000 students choose all their answers randomly. Some of the expected marks are obtained. Okay. First of all, forget this 1000 students. In a 150 mark paper, okay, each question has 4 choices. So correct choice has a probability 1/4. Right? Now, so correct choice has a probability 1/4. Thank you, Palash. Correct choice has a probability 1/4. Wrong choice has a probability 3/4. So 1/4 of the answers will give you 1 mark. 3/4 of the answers will give you minus 0.25 marks. Okay? Now, you have 150 questions. So 150 divided by 4 gives you 1 mark, which is going to be 75 divided by 2, 317.5. So 37.5 is the probability of 1 mark. How many times will you get minus 2.5? 3 out of 4 times you will select the wrong answer. So never select your answers randomly in tests. Okay. Wow, thanks, sir. That's great. So 3 out of 4 times you will select the wrong answer. 3 out of 4 times of 150. So again, if you look at this, minus 0.25 is just 1 by 4. Minus 1 by 4. So 154 again, I get 37.5. And 37.5 up here. So into 3, 37.5 into 3 is 75 plus 37.5, 0.5, 12, 7 plus 3, 10, 112.5 into minus 4. So 112/5. Okay, this is a lot of maths. Something I must have done wrong. I'm just going to guess the answer and see how they got the answer. Expected marks per question. Okay, same thing. 1 by 16. Oh, I did extra work. probability of the correct answer out of 4, 1 mark. Probability of wrong answer, minus 0.25. I just had to add this. So that means 1 out of 16 marks you will get. So 1 out of 16, so if there are 1000 students and 150 questions, just divide that by 16 and you will get the answer, calculator, whatever this is. It was a very straightforward question. Yeah, you just have minus 0.25 if it's a wrong answer, plus 1 if it's a right answer. 4 choices are given, so 3 of them will be wrong, 1 of them will be correct, 1 out of 16 will be the correct value. And you have 1000 students, so 1000 upon 16, and each test is 150 marks. Just calculate this. That was it. Now, what's the next question? 2 n-bit binary strings. Binary string means it's a values are 0 or 1. So just 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0. Yeah, that's it. So the question goes, chosen randomly with uniform probability. Okay. Hamming distance between the two strings is equal to d. Okay, this is a tough problem. I'm just going to guess and see how to do it. Hamming distance can be any value between 0 and n. Hamming distance is number of different bits. Okay. Okay, skip. Point is randomly selected with the uniform probability in the x file. Yeah, you can get this link, of course, why not? So, point is randomly selected with uniform probability in xy plane, okay, within the rectangle, okay. So, I have this xy plane. Welcome, welcome. I have this xy plane, here's one corner, next corner is here, 1,0, 0,0, one corner is at 1,2, 1,2, 1,2, and the last corner is at 0,2. So this rectangle is made. Now, if p is the length of the position vector of the point, expected value of p square is, so there's a point inside this rectangle. P is the length of the position vector of the point. I don't know what's a position vector. Should I Google it or guess? Okay, it's P square. So I'm going to go with 1. First of all, minimum value of P can be 0 if the point chosen is 0,0. Okay. Then the length of position. Okay, position vector just means how far is it from the origin. Maximum value can be root 5 when the point chosen is 1,2. Okay, I'll just draw this again. So at 0,0, distance from origin is 0. Palash, thank you. At 1,2, what's the distance? Year 2 and year 1. So Pythagoras theorem will tell us that this distance is equal to root of 2 square plus 1 square, which is root 5. So our least value is 0, our biggest value is root 5. This is the longest line and the shortest line is on that point itself, right? So now when we look at it, we just have root 5, 0 to root 5, and we need to do p square. So I don't know exactly which formula this is, but looks like you just have to put this in the formula from 0 to root 5, probability of p. It's uniform, so they integrated the square, which made it 1 upon p, or p cube by 3, sorry, p cube by 3, from 0 to root 5. Okay, inside this equation, in the position of p, okay, inside the value of p, they have replaced root 5. So that time when they replaced root 5, they got root 5 upon root 5 cancelled, became 1 upon 3. And they have replaced it as 0. So that's how they got the answer. Again, this looks like a very tricky problem. I'm not sure I need to do it properly. PE denotes the probability of event E. Probability A is 1, probability B is half, value of p given a and p b given a respectively are. So this is conditional probability. I don't remember the formula. Conditional probability formula. So probability of a given that b has occurred, that is the condition, is equal to probability of a and b both divided by probability of b. So probability of a and b both, which will be probability of a and b both divided by probability of b. So 1 into half divided by half. 1, is that it? That looks like that answer is 1. So I'll just going to select the answer in which a, b is 1. Correct? That was it. Just a formula question. Conditional probability formula. Same formula they are telling us here. Probability of a given that the condition b has happened. So that was it for that. Just apply the formula and go ahead. Which page am I on? Yeah, I was on page 3. Program two modules executed sequentially. Okay, probability density functions of time taken to execute these two modules. So there are two functions, two things are happening that are taking a particular time, t and f2t. Overall time taken is sum of these two points or what? Max of these two points. So they happen sequentially, means only after he is finished, he takes place. So I'm going to go with sum. Wrong. You need to do integration of the first point and of not the second point. I don't understand exactly what's happening. Assume total time to be t units. Okay. F1 executes for f units, x units. First event takes x time. Sequentially, so f2 is executed for t minus x. Apply convolution to the sum of two independent random variables. Okay. I don't know what this. Oh, so in integration, when you want to find out the sum of two areas, I think you just multiply them. Area under two curves. I don't know that. Four fair coins simultaneous. One head, one tail. Nice. So probability that at least one head and at least one tail. Four coins are there. Out of four coins, what is the probability that there will be no head? Probability of no head in four coins is just one case, which is tail, 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 tail. Right? So that is one case out of all the four factorial cases. Basically, two raised to four cases, right? Sorry. Because it's either head or tail into head or tail into head or tail into head or tail for each of the four positions. So 1 upon 2 raised to 4. Then what is the probability of no heads, no tails, sorry, no tails, that is head, 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 head. So again, that probability is same, 1 upon 2 raised to 4. So 1 minus 1 upon 2 raised to 4 into 2, this gets cancelled, this becomes 3. 1 upon 2 raised to 3 is 1 upon 8. 1 minus 1 upon 8 becomes 7 upon 8. So my answer is going to be 7 upon 8. Let's see if I'm wrong. Only two cases where all head, all tail. Yeah, that's the logic. 7 car accidents in a week. Probability that they all occurred on the same day. Okay. First of all, 7 accidents. How many days in the week? 7 days. First accident took place on Monday. 1 out of 7 chance. Second accident took place on Monday, 1 out of 7. Third, 1 out of 7. Like this, 7 times. So 1 out of 7 raised to 7. Now, it doesn't have to be Monday, right? It can be Tuesday or anything. So 7 on top. 7, 7 cancel. 7 raised to 6. Just let me know. Camera option to the right. Thanks, Abhi. Good one. Good one, thank you. Thank you, Abhi. So again, car accidents in a week. How many days are there in the week? First of all, we have 7 days in the week, right? Now, I need to know, one second, what happened to my mouse? Yeah. Now, out of these 7 days, one accident has taken place, okay? Seven accidents have taken place. So if one accident took place, it would be 1/7. Seven accidents have taken place. So this becomes 7 raised to 7. Seven cancel with this 7, 7 raised to 6. That's how I got the answer. I'll make sure not to draw behind my face, right? Yeah, same for all 6 days. E1 and E2 are events in a probability space satisfying the following constraints. They both have the same probability and their union is equal to 1 and they're independent. So if both of these add up to 1, that means both of them are same. That means both of them have to be half. Okay. Something else. Oh, they are independent, so they are different. Whew, they are same. Union is 1. Union is equal to probability E1 plus E2 minus intersection. They are independent, so intersection is equal to E1 into E2. 1 into 1 is 1. So if this entire thing is 1, okay, if this is 1, this is 1, these two we don't know, and this is also 1. Let both of these be x since they are both the same. So obviously, what is the value of x? Simple maths, 2 comes here, 2 gets cancelled, x is 1. So the probability is 1. I did not consider this properly. Same thing, they did this XXX, 2X, yeah. Another solution, independent events, union, given, forget that. Okay, so somebody has an internet connection of 100 Mbps, lucky person. Shared by its subscribers, not lucky. All the subscribers are active 50% of the time. Probability of being active or independent, ISP has promised 25 Mbps to 6 subscribers. Okay, so at a time 3 people are using it. Okay, I don't know the answer, but look at the denominators are all different, so I'll think of something. 25 Mbps, 2 is 6 people is what he's promised, and they're active 50% of the time. So how many are active at a particular time? 3. Each needs 25, 75, they'll all get it. Success. But I have 6 guys, so there will be some cases when 4 are active or 5 are active or 6 are active. Need to consider those cases. So if this is 75%, those will be 25%. I think that logic should work. Otherwise, some formula or something. 1/4 and 1/4, so 1/4. No, it's all wrong. Logic is something else. Binomial experiment is to be done. Okay, so we just have to apply the binomial formula. Online or offline, something like that. When there are 5 users, when there are 6 users. That's when we want to calculate. I don't like that question, so I'm not going to read it too much. 3-game tournament between 2 teams. Every team results in every match, win or loss. If you win 2 or more, you win the series. Probability of winning the first game for both teams is half. So first game, half probability of winning. Probability for a team to win a game again is 2/3. So your second game you'll win 2/3 chance. Probability of winning a game after a loss. So here this is the person who lost. His probability of winning this game is 1/3. Right, 2/3 and 1/3. What is the probability for a team to win the series after losing the first game? So he lost the first game. So he has to win the next game, right? After winning the next game, he has to win the next game again. So total becomes 1/2 sorry, I wrote behind my face. 1 by 2, first game is lost. So winning the second game becomes 1 by 3. Winning the third game after a win becomes 2 by 3. 3, 3 cancel, answer is 1 by 9. Wrong, 2 by 9. How? 3 games to win. Win at least 2. Probability to win second game, 1/3. Oh, I forgot the 2 in the numerator, sorry. A is 2, 3, 4, 5. B is 11, 12, 13, 14, 15. Two numbers are randomly selected, one from each set. Okay. Probability that the sum equals 16. So, how many ways to get 16 from these two numbers, these two pairs? I can have 14 and 2. Or I can have 13 and 3. Or I can have, can I have anything else? 12 and 4. What else? 12 and 4 and 11 and 5. So 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 situations are there. In total, how many are possible? 4 from here and 5 from here. So out of 20, I have 4 chances. 4 upon 20, simple maths, 1s are 5s are. 1 upon 5 is same as saying 0.2. So 1 upon 5 is 0.2. That's the question, all done. Right, these 4 pairs, as I wrote, favorable upon total. Maths, physics, chem, MPC. Student has 75% chance of at least 1, 50 of at least 2, 40% of exactly 2. Okay, some relations are given. And okay, I don't like this. I'm not aiming for that type of question. Suppose xi for 1 to 3, independent, identical, probability mass function, xor. Okay, I think I'm done. What is my, yeah, it went up, so I'm done. Next half I'll do some other time. Thanks for watching and keep practicing. Bye. I need to study overall PMF, PDF, and I need to do some problems on permutations combinations. Yeah, I'll practice those next time. Comfortable with basic probability in this video I've covered, and I've also covered all the problems on expectation and a few problems on binomial theorem. I think that's enough for now. Yeah. Thank you for watching, guys. Bye bye.